Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala nabiyil karim wa ala alihi wa ashabi ajma'in. Welcome to this virtual khutbah on tawakkul. Unfortunately, we had to close the masjid this week. This is our first week in a few months without Jum'ah. Reminds me of early last year. But unfortunately, the virus is getting out of control in our community and we have to keep our distance from each other, and so the safest thing to do over the next few weeks is to stay in our homes. So instead of having this khutbah at the masjid, we will have this khutbah from home. And just a bit of fiqh to before we get into the actual khutbah, I'm of the opinion that Jum'ah cannot be prayed at home. I do know that there is another opinion in our community that Jum'ah can be prayed at home. So whichever opinion you're following, just make sure you're following the opinion that you believe is strongest and an opinion held by ulama. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do this virtual khutbah and then I'm going to pray Zuhr with my family. And I would recommend that you do the same. The topic I've chosen for today, actually, this topic I was going to deliver it at the masjid last week, but at the last minute I changed my topic last week to that of lessons from the life of Isa alayhi salam, and so this topic I was going to deliver it at the masjid this week, but Qadarullah, we had to close this week, so instead this will be a live online presentation rather than a khutbah delivered at the masjid. So the topic is tawakkul. And I've actually done this khutbah before at a different masjid 2 years ago, but a reminder is beneficial for the believers, and really in the time that we're living in right now, tawakkul is so important. This is like, it's something that we need, that we all need in times like this. So I'm going to give a rather detailed discussion about tawakkul, because what I find to be a problem for many of us is that we all know what tawakkul is theoretically. We all know this theory of tawakkul. We all know this idea that we must have tawakkul in difficult times, that we must have tawakkul in Allah. But how? How do we have tawakkul? How do we show tawakkul? How do we practice tawakkul? This is something that's not talked about as often as it should be, right? The practical side of tawakkul. And I actually found a few years ago a really practical guide to tawakkul. I summarized it on my website. The link is actually posted to the website. It's posted. The link is linked to this video. And I've taken this from the Madarij al-Salikin of Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah, rahimahullah, the chapter on Manzilat al-Tawakkul, the status of tawakkul, where he gives a detailed 7-step process on how to practice tawakkul. And by the way, if you don't understand Arabic, alhamdulillah, one of the head writers at Yaqeen Institute, Dr. Uemir Anjum, has published a translation of this book recently. A really beautiful translation that you should be able to find in some bookstores around the world, inshallah. It's definitely worth looking into. So this is an excellent book by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyah on the different levels of piety, and one of those levels is tawakkul. So what is tawakkul? How do we practice it? And what can we do today to practice it in the modern world? So tawakkul means to trust Allah. And if there's anything I've seen in this past year, is that many of us misunderstand what trusting Allah is altogether. Just to give you a couple of examples, I've had this conversation very often this year, that I'd meet a Muslim brother who's not wearing a mask, and he would judge me for wearing a mask, saying, "Oh, you're wearing a mask, that means you don't have tawakkul in Allah." That's a very nonsensical argument, and this clearly shows that these individuals don't know what tawakkul is. I mean, you wouldn't walk into traffic and say, "I have tawakkul in Allah." You wouldn't walk into a department of a hospital where there's only people with contagious diseases and say, "You have tawakkul in Allah." No, you're going to take your precautions. You're going to do what you need to do in order to have tawakkul. I mean, the same brothers don't sit at home waiting for their risk. Our risk is already ordained. Why don't we do that? We all go out and we work to earn our risk, right? So this clearly shows a lack of understanding in our community of what is tawakkul. Likewise, there are people who are saying things like, oh, if you believe the diseases are contagious, then you don't have tawakkul. Again, this is a nonsensical argument, right? Because diseases being contagious is something proven by science. It's something proven by life experience. It's something that's known of this world by necessity. So the idea that believing in contagious diseases goes against tawakkul once again so shows that a lot of people simply don't know what tawakkul is. So tawakkul means to trust Allah. And Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah mentions that there are seven levels of this trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we need to do seven things in order to actualize tawakkul in our lives. And interestingly, step number two is to adopt the means, to do what you need to do physically. So tawakkul, part of the process of tawakkul is to physically do what you need to do. It's not enough to simply say, I trust Allah. That's not enough. It's not enough to simply sit back and say, oh, I trust Allah. Nothing's going to happen to me except Allah wills. That's true. But Allah has created this world as a world of asbab, a world of means. And you have to take the means to earn the trust of Allah, to earn the protection of Allah, to earn the mercy of Allah. It all comes about through actual practice. So how do we earn protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? We do it through tawakkul. How do we practice tawakkul? Well, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah, in this book, he highlights seven things. Seven things we should do, that if we do these seven things, then inshallah, we will have tawakkul, right? So what's number one? Number one to have tawakkul is to recognize the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala related to tawakkul. What do we mean by this? Well, tawakkul is really, it really comes from a place of firm belief in who Allah is. What do we mean by that? We mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is in control of everything. Reflect on that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who controls our qadr. Reflect on that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one without whose will nothing can happen. Right? Reflect on that. So Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah says that the first step to tawakkul is to reflect on the names and attributes of Allah. Allah is Ar-Razzaq, He is the provider. Allah is Ar-Rahman, He is most merciful. Allah is Al-Jabbar, He is the one who has power over everything. When you reflect on the names of Allah, your tawakkul grows strong. Right? You know your rizq is only from Allah. Anything that happens to you is only from Allah. Nothing occurs except by the will of Allah. And so the first step of tawakkul is to reflect on the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Without a correct aqidah in the names and attributes of Allah, our tawakkul will be deficient. Interestingly, step number two, according to Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, right at the very beginning, is to take up your asbab, to adopt the means. What does this mean? This means tawakkul in Islam is not an inactive thing. It's not something where you just sit back, relax, and wait for your rizq, wait for your safety, wait for your health. No, you have to do what is within your capabilities. And we see this in the examples in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the example of Maryam alayhi salam. When she is pregnant and she is hungry, Allah tells her to touch a tree. And when she touches the tree, the dates begin to fall down. Now, anyone who's been near a date palm tree knows that just touching it, especially when you're in a state of weakness, isn't going to make the dates fall down. If Allah wanted, He could have made the dates fall down without her doing anything at all. Why did He make her touch that tree? To show that you do what's within your ability and Allah takes care of the rest. The same thing with Musa alayhi salam and his stick to part the ocean. Allah does not need Musa alayhi salam to touch a sea with a stick for it to part. Allah parts it as He wishes. But this is again tawakkul. You do what's within your capabilities, Allah takes care of the rest. So adapting the means is part of tawakkul. If you want rizq, you go to work and then you trust Allah. If you want health, you take your precautions and then you trust Allah. If you want anything, you have to take up the worldly means and then trust Allah. To sit back and do nothing is not tawakkul. It is something that is actually in some cases punishable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, if a man is not going out to earn his rizq and expecting Allah to just drop his rizq upon him, yeah, Allah may send him his rizq. Allah may send him his rizq to charity, to inheritance, to a gift, to some other means. He may still get his rizq. but there won't be barakah in it, there won't be any pleasure of Allah in it. And on the day of judgment, when Allah asks you, how did you earn it, you're not going to have an honorable answer. So your rizq may still come to you, but it's not going to come with honor and barakah if you do not take up the means. So step number two of tawakkul is to adopt your means. Step number three is to have a heart that is rooted in tawheed, to remove all shak, all doubts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanAllah, you know, this is something many of us don't think about when we think about tawakkul. Do we have any doubts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Think about this, right? A lot of times when you tell people, oh, don't do that business practice, it's haram, they will say things like, how am I going to make money if I don't do this? This is a doubt about Allah being Ar-Razzaq. This is a doubt about Allah being the source of our sustenance, that all risk comes from Allah. Because if you think you cannot earn your risk except through haram, then you have doubts about Allah being Ar-Razzaq. So that's why Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah says that step number three of tawakkul is to remove doubts from our hearts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have firm tawheed. My risk is from Allah. I do not need haram to earn my risk. I do not need haram to become wealthy. Whatever is meant for me is going to come to me, whether I take a halal path or a haram path, right? And so this, when you have this firm tawakkul, you will avoid the haram and you will choose the halal part, because you know either way you're going to get what is written for you. The only difference is when you choose the halal part, it is blessed. When you choose the haram part, it is cursed. But either way, you are getting what is written for you. So to remove doubts from our heart is part of tawakkul. Number four is to ask of Allah. So look at the step by step. You first actualize and understand and believe in the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is Ar-Razzaq, He is the one in control, He is the Rabbul Alameen. Then you adopt your means. Then you remove doubts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from your mind. And then you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is step by step tawakkul. You're starting a business. You understand your risk is from Allah, not from the business. You understand that Allah is Ar-Razzaq and this is simply a means through which you earn your risk. You then adopt your means. You do your business with ihsan in the absolute best possible way. You remove doubts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning you do not do your business in a haram way because you have absolutely no doubt that your risk is from Allah. And then you ask Allah. After doing your business with ihsan, in the evening when you go home, you raise your hands and you ask Allah, oh Allah, put barakah in what I have done and make it sufficient for me. You make dua, Allahumma akfini bi halalik an haramik wa aghnini bi fadlika amman siwak. Very important dua to memorize and to make every single day. Allahumma akfini bi halalik an haramik wa aghnini bi fadlika amman siwak. This dua translates as, oh Allah, make the halal sufficient for me against the haram and make me independent of everyone besides you. It's one of my favorite du'as. It's really a part of tawakkul to make this du'a. We should be making this du'a every single day. Allahumma akfini bi halalik an haramik wa aghnini bi fadlika amman siwak. Right? Step number five, husnudhan billah. Husnudhan billah. To think good about Allah. To think good about Allah. Optimism. Our religion is an optimistic religion. It is a religion where we think good about Allah, where we think good about the future, where our thoughts about what is going to happen are nothing but khair. We expect only good from our Lord. It is mentioned in the Hadith Qudsi that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I am as my servant thinks of me. So think good about Allah. Right, so when you start a business, you think good about Allah. Allah is going to put barakah in this business. Allah is going to bless this business. Allah is going to take care of me through this business. When you take your precautions to preserve your health, you think good about Allah. Allah is going to take care of my health. Allah is not going to allow anything to happen to me that is beyond my abilities to deal with. Whatever it is, when you put your tawakkul in Allah, that tawakkul must be with husnudhan billah, with thinking good about Allah. It is not tawakkul to think bad about Allah. It is not tawakkul to start a business and then to think Allah is not going to bless this, it's going to do terribly, we're not going to do well, I'm not going to survive. That's not tawakkul. Part of tawakkul is husnudhan billah, to think the best about Allah, to expect the best from Allah, to go into whatever you are doing with full optimism in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to expect good in your qadr. So after you do all of this, After you do all of this, after you do the, you put your trust in Allah and you recognize Allah's attributes and you remove the doubts about Allah from your heart and you think good about Allah, the next step is to accept your qadr. The next step is to accept your qadr. Whatever comes to you, this is from Allah. This is what Allah willed. So if you are running a business and you did it to the best of your ability and you put your tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you were content with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you did all of this and then you didn't make much profit, you know, you made maybe a small profit, then whatever you received is from Allah and you accept that this is what Allah willed for me. Likewise, if you did everything that you are supposed to do when it comes to your health, you social distanced, you sanitized, you avoided touching people, you stayed at home, but you still got sick, Qadarullah, we accept the Qadar of Allah, right? So we expect the best from Allah, but at the end of the day, whatever happens after we have taken the means, after we have taken up the asbab, after we have made dua, after we have had husnul zan billah, whatever happens after that, we accept it as Qadarullah, and we understand this is what's best for us, even if we don't understand why, even if we don't understand how, right? So we just submit to the Qadar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we don't fight Allah about it. We don't fight to Allah. We don't say, oh Allah, I stayed at home, why did you make me sick? This kind of word should not come out on the tongue of the believer. Rather, the believer should say, Qadarullah ma sha'a fa'ala. This is Allah's Qadar, He does what He wills. That is what should come on our tongue when it comes to whatever we receive. And this is for both the good and the bad. Because when we look at the story in Surah Al-Kahf of the man and the garden, he had received good in his Qadar. He had received a beautiful lush garden that was profitable and he was boasting about it. And what did his neighbor tell him? Why don't you say, MashaAllah, Qadr, MashaAllah, this is what Allah wills, right? So this is not only to do with bad, but good as well. If you receive good, Qadarullah, this is Allah's Qadr. If you receive bad, Qadarullah, this is Allah's Qadr. Either way, we accept the Qadr of Allah and we say this is what is best for us, right? And the final step of tawakkul is to live a life of actualizing it in actualizing tawakkul in our lives, and handing over the matter to Allah completely. This is called tafweed, to completely hand over the matter to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Say, oh Allah, I leave this to you now. We see this, for example, in the story of the Battle of Badr, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he adopted his means, he went out with the army, they chose a strategic location, they were armed, and then he made dua, and then after that, you know, Abu Bakr told him, okay, that's enough now, let's put our trust in Allah and go out and fight. So at the end of the day, they left the result of the battle to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it reaches a point where it's just handing it over to Allah. I've done everything in my capabilities. I now just leave it to Allah. I'm not going to stress about it. I'm not going to worry about it. Whatever happens next is Qadarullah. So for example, if you are running a business, then you worked hard. You ran the business to the best of your ability. You made dua every day. You were optimistic. You were ready to accept Qadar. Now you relax. In the evening, you relax. You know, whatever profits come to me, that's what Allah will. I'm not going to stress about it because Allah knows what's best for me. Same with our health. You social distance. You sanitized. You stayed home, right? You made dua. You avoided interacting with people. You did all of that. Now don't stress and worry about the virus. Don't stress and worry about it. Now just hand the matter over to Allah. And just simply say, I am doing everything I need to do. I am making dua. I am staying home. I am avoiding interacting with people. Now whatever happens is Qadarullah. I'm not going to stress about it. Whatever happens to me next is what Allah willed for me. It is what is best for me. I'm not going to stress about it. This last step, handing the matter over to Allah. And notice this is the last step, not the first step, right? You start off by adopting your means and then at the end, you hand the matter over to Allah. Some people misunderstand tawakkul and they take this as the only step. They don't take the means, they don't make dua, they don't think about tawheed. They simply leave it to Allah and they end up, you know, making a mess of it, Rather, this is the final step after doing everything else. The benefit of this step is it removes anxiety from the heart. This is the benefit of the final step. That when we are trusting Allah completely with our hearts, then there is no anxiety. There is no anxiety in our hearts. Because we know Allah will only allow to happen what is best for us. So these are the 7 steps of tawakkul, as listed by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah in his Madarij al-Salikin. To repeat, you begin by recognizing the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You then do what you need to do. You adopt your means. You work. You take care of your health. All of this. Number 3, you remove any doubts in your heart about Tawheed, about Allah. Number 4, you ask Allah. You make dua. Number 5, you have husnul dhan billah. You think best about Allah. Number 6, you accept your qadr. You prepare your mind to accept qadr. And then number 7, you just hand it over to Allah. Now there is a bonus 8th step. There is a bonus step, an 8th step, that not only is it part of tawakkul, but it's the higher level of tawakkul. So when it comes to piety, there are different levels, right? So even when it comes to tawakkul, there are different levels. There is the tawakkul of the average Muslim, and then there's the tawakkul of the awliya. Now how do we get to that level? This is very hard, but this is very important. If you want to move up in your ranks in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want to move from having tawakkul on the average level to having the tawakkul of the awliya and earning the status of the awliya, there is one more step that one has to take. And that step is rada bil qada, to be happy with your qada. And this is the hardest step of all. You see, the tawakkul of the average Muslim, that which is acceptable to Allah, is to be accepting of your qada. Whatever happens, it's what Allah will. Higher than that, the level of the awliya is to be pleased with one's qadr. Not just to accept it, but to be happy with it. And you know, you see this amongst the Sahaba and the early Muslims, that even when bad things happen to them, they would say Alhamdulillah. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was like this, that even when something that we perceive to be bad happened to him, he would say Alhamdulillah. And he would look for the good in it. And he would be pleased with the qadr of Allah in all situations. This is very hard. This is very hard, especially when tragedy strikes, especially when we face trauma. To be pleased with the qadr of Allah at times like that, this is not something that's expected of the average Muslim. But if someone can achieve this, it can make them a friend of Allah. It can elevate them to the status of an awliya Allah, of a wali Allah. This is really something amazing. It's something not all of us are capable of, but it's a degree to aspire towards, right? At first, let's get the other 7 steps in order and at least have proper tawakkul of Allah. And I really hope that what I have shown you here is a practical guide to tawakkul. You know, just not something theoretical that we say, I have tawakkul, but practical steps to take. And again, you can read the full article to learn more. You know, to follow these practical steps, tawakkul then becomes something we can do every day. But if you want to reach a higher level of piety, it's not enough to have tawakkul. We also must be pleased with the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I know that's not easy and that's not expected of us. But if someone can do that, they will have a higher status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so I want to end with one last dua, a very beautiful dua. This is the closing verse of Surah Tawbah. Hasbi Allahu la ilaha illahu alayhi tawakkaltu wa huwa rabbul arshil azim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever says this 7 times every morning and evening, Allah will take care of all of his affairs. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever says hasbi Allahu la ilaha illahu alaihi tawakkaltu wa rabbul arshil azim, Allah is sufficient for me, there is no god but him, in him I put my tawakkul, and he is the lord of the mighty throne. This beautiful dua, this verse of the Quran, the sunnah dua, the closing verse of Surah Tawbah mentioned in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever mentions this 7 times every morning and evening, Allah will take care of all of his affairs. So let us revive the sunnah of reciting Hasbi Allahu la ilaha illahu alayhi tawakkaltu wa rabbul arshil azim every morning after Fajr 7 times, every evening after Maghrib 7 times, and then putting our trust in Allah and doing what we need to do. May Allah make us from those who actualize tawakkul in our lives. May He make us from the people of tawakkul in how we live, in what we practice, and may He grant us the best of this world and the next. May Allah make our qadr for the rest of our lives and our afterlives nothing but khair and nothing what is good for us, and to make us from the people who get khair fi dunya and khair fi akhirah, and those who are protected from Jahannam. سبحان ربي أما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاك الله خير والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.